Today we will be doing directive principles of state policy. So in directive principles of state policy, today we are going to have a look at the relationship between fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy. So in the last two classes, we've already had a look at what fundamental rights are, what directive principles of state policy are, and at the same time, how the directive principles of state policy have been implemented so far. Okay, so today we will have a look at the relationship between directive principles of state policy and fundamental rights. Now, constitution, as we know, it is the supreme law of the land. So constitution is a set of rules and regulations according to which a country is to be governed, isn't it? So the government also derives its power from the constitution. So no one is above the constitution, okay? So the preamble, which we have already discussed, which is an introduction to the constitution, which gives us a brief idea as to what are the contents of the constitution, what kind of state should India be, isn't it? And what are the objectives which Indian state should achieve. So more or less we already have a rough idea about preamble. Then we discuss about the fundamental rights. So why are fundamental rights important? So besides the rules and regulations, how it is very important for the citizens to enjoy certain amount of rights and privileges so that there is an all-around development of the individual. So there are six fundamental rights guaranteed to us by the Indian constitution. Okay, so which helps an all-around development of the individual. So these are usually the rights which each and every individual is supposed to enjoy. Okay, and then we discuss about the directive principles. So these are directions given to the union and the state government. That means when they are making the rules and regulations or when they are making the policies, it has to be made in such a way that it caters to the social and economic needs of the individual. Okay, so these are important features of the constitution. So the directive principles of the state policy is enshrined in part 4 of the Indian constitution, and the fundamental rights have been guaranteed in part 3 of the Indian constitution. So though fundamental rights and directive principles appear as distinct entities in the constitution, but with the passage of time it has been drawn that no distinction takes place between the positive and negative obligations of the state. So many a times, sometimes there might be a controversy with regard to the fundamental rights and the directive principles of state policy. Okay, so though these fundamental rights are justiciable, that means when any of your fundamental rights have been taken away, you can go to the courts and fight for your rights, but on the other hand, with regard to the directive principles, it is not justiciable. See? So many a times conflicts or controversies may exist between the fundamental rights and the directive principles of state policy. Okay? But you have to remember that they are two sides of the same coin. So on one hand, your fundamental rights is going to take into consideration your political rights, isn't it? And on the other hand, when you look at the directive principles of state policy, it caters to your social and economic rights. Okay, so these are the two sides of the same coin. So you cannot think that you are supposed to enjoy only your fundamental rights, or fundamental rights are superior than your directive principles of state policy. And on the other hand, you cannot say now directive principles are most essential because it is going to help the development of the social and economic conditions of the people, isn't it? Or you cannot say now directive principles are more powerful than the fundamental rights. Okay, but both your fundamental rights as well as your directive principles of state policy has to go side by side. Okay, so you cannot think of fundamental rights without the directive principles of state policy, and at the same time you cannot think of directive principles of state policy without your fundamental rights. Okay, so these two have to go side by side. Now let's have a look at fundamental rights. Now fundamental rights deal with civil and political rights. Isn't it your civil rights, your political rights, isn't it your right to equality, your right to freedom, constitutional educational right? So these were the different rights which we discussed when we are discussing about the fundamental rights. So it has got to do with the civil and political rights of the individual. So why are these rights known as fundamental? Because they are the basic rights, isn't it? So with the help of which an individual can develop to his fullest. Because every time we may be following the rules and regulations, isn't it? But certain amount of freedom, some certain amount of rights have to be enjoyed by the people so that there is all around development. Okay? So whereas directive principles of state policy deals with social and economic rights. So social and economic rights. So when we were discussing the directive principles of state policy, so we had to look at the socialist principle, the Gandhian principle, the liberal principle, the general principle, isn't it? So more or less it was centered around the social and economic rights of the people. Equal wages to be given both to the men and the women, and especially if laborers are working, so they are also supposed to be given certain amount of benefit. The mother was also given a lot of emphasis, the child was also given a lot of emphasis, isn't it? And no discrimination was to be made on the basis of caste, creed, color. So more or less these were all supposed to do with your social and economic rights, okay, under your directive principles of state policy. Directive principles of state policy are not enforceable in a court of law, but it doesn't mean it is subordinate. So, these directive principles of state policy are not justiciable. That means you cannot go to the court and find favor. You cannot say, now, since you are a woman, okay, and you are being paid less. So you cannot go to the court and say, I am working in a construction site, but I have been given less amount of money. You cannot do that, isn't it? But on the basis of your fundamental rights, your right to equality, so on that basis you can fight for your rights. That means right to equality means there shouldn't be any discrimination based on the caste, creed, color, isn't it, or the gender. So on that basis you can fight for your rights, okay? So, but even if you are not paid properly, isn't it, and you cannot go to the court and fight for your rights, it does not mean that your directive principle is less powerful than your fundamental rights. So, in all these cases, what they are trying to explain is that fundamental rights and directive principles go together. That means it has to go side by side. So, as I said, isn't it? So if a woman is being paid less for the work she is doing, so under directive principles, she might not be able to fight for her rights. But on the basis of your fundamental rights, she can go to the court and fight for her rights. Because one of the rights which has been guaranteed to us is your fundamental right, that is right to equality. Isn't it? So you cannot discriminate on the basis of caste, creed, color, or the gender. So on that basis, you can fight for your rights. So that means your fundamental rights and your directive principles of state policy go side by side. You cannot say fundamental right is more important than your directive principles of state policy, or on the other hand, you cannot say your directive principles are more important than your fundamental rights. So both have their own position, both are important in one way or the other. Okay? Now, looking at the relationship between directive principles of state policy and your fundamental rights, now let's have a look at it. Now, the directive principles of state policy are embodied in part 4 of the Indian Constitution and are a unique feature of our Constitution. That means the fundamental rights has already been mentioned in part 3 of the Indian Constitution, isn't it? It is supposed to do with your civil and your political rights, isn't it? But what about your social and economic rights? So they have not been mentioned in the fundamental rights, but it is there mentioned in the directive principles of state policy. That means when the government, both at the union and the center, they are making the laws, so they have to make laws in such a way that it caters to the social and economic needs of the people. Okay, because all of this, that means India is heading for a welfare state. So what is a welfare state? A welfare state is a state that caters to the social, economic, social, political needs of the individuals, isn't it? So on that basis, your union and the state government have to make policies in such a way that there is a marked improvement in the social and economic conditions of the individual. Okay, so besides the fundamental rights, on the other hand, the directive principles is going to cater to your social and economic rights. Okay? So besides the precedent of the Irish Constitution, so we already know the directive principle of state policy has been borrowed from the Irish Constitution. Okay, that means the Constitution of Ireland. So the basic inspiration or the directive principles chapter came from the concept of a welfare state. So welfare state means which caters to the social, economic, your religious, your cultural needs of the individual. So for that, a directive principles of state policy plays an important role. Now, while seeking to protect the basic rights of the individuals, the framers of the constitution also wanted it to be an effective instrument for social revolution. So the possible conflict between the rights of the individual and their needs of the community was sought to be resolved on one hand by hedging the fundamental rights themselves by necessary restrictions, public interest, and on the other by incorporating a chapter on the more positive directive principles of state policy. So now your fundamental rights are there, isn't it? So it has been guaranteed to you by the constitution. So there are six fundamental rights. So besides these six fundamental rights, because these were mainly your civil and political rights, but besides your, because in your fundamental rights also there are some restrictions, isn't it? That means right to equality. So right to equality does not mean that you come in the same category, isn't it? That means maybe a male and a female, isn't it? So though it is based on equality, but there are some restrictions. Equality does not mean that you are supposed to enjoy all the benefit. You are supposed to get all the opportunity. And the women are not supposed to get any opportunity at all. Isn't it? So there are some restrictions. So right to equality also does not mean perfect right to equality. So with certain amount of exceptions are there. Now let's take the example of right to freedom. So right to freedom means you have the freedom to move anywhere you want, isn't it? Freedom to practice and propagate any religion of your choice. But again, there is restriction, isn't it? That means since you have the right to follow any religion of your choice, now you can go and start converting the person, okay, of other religion and ask him or her to follow your faith, isn't it? So there is certain amount of restriction there in your fundamental rights. Okay, but with regard to your directive principles of state policy, it is concerned more with your social and economic life. So that's why your fundamental rights and directive principles has to go side by side. Now, Article 37 declares that the directive principles are fundamental in governance of the country. That means when the union and the state government are making the rules and regulations, so they have to abide by the directive principles. So they have to keep in mind what sort of law they are supposed to make, what sort of policy they are supposed to make, isn't it? So they have to make rules and regulations in such a way that it caters to the social economic needs of the individual. So no discrimination needs to be made, isn't it? And at the same time, benefits to be given to the lower section of the society, isn't it? People belonging to the backward class or people belonging to the shadow caste, shadow tribe, isn't it? So that has to be kept in mind when the government is making the rules and regulations. Okay, so these are fundamentally in governance of the country, and that it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. So whenever the union of the state government is making the laws, so it has to keep these directive principles in mind. The socialist principle, the Gandhian principle, isn't it? Or the general principles, or the liberal principles. So laws have to be made in such a way. Okay, so that each and everyone is benefiting from the laws which are made by the state government. Otherwise, if the laws are meant only for the rich people, if laws are meant only for the educated people, then what about those uneducated people? What about those poor people? Is it? So they are also citizens of the state, but they are not getting any benefit. They are not receiving any benefit from the government. Is it? So that's why the government, while making the rules and regulations, have to keep these directive principles in mind. Okay? So that it is both for the educated people, as well as the uneducated, for the rich, as well as for the poor. Isn't it? For example, now the right to education has become compulsory. It has been one of your fundamental rights. So the educated are already educated. They have already received the education. But what about the other illiterate people? Isn't it? Other illiterate people. So the rights education has been made compulsory for them, so that there is balance in the society. In the same way, now the rich are going on, they already earn a large amount of income. But what about the poor? So maybe the government has to find out ways and means by which the poor people can also fulfill their basic needs of food, clothing and shelter, so that no one suffers, isn't it, from hunger, from unemployment. We've discussed it last time, isn't it? So your fundamental rights and your liberty principles have to go side by side. Or when the government is making the rules and regulations, so it has to keep in mind the social and economic needs of the people. So that can be done with the help of these two liberty principles of state policy, okay? Now, so thus it is clear that these constitutional directives were not intended to be merely moral precepts, but were to be treated as positive mandates and part and parcel of the human rights provision of the constitution. Because according to the constitution, isn't it? So everyone should be equal, everyone should enjoy the same amount of rights, same amount of privileges. So if the fundamental rights are unable to fulfill it, so you have the directive principles of state policy, which will cater to the rest of the rights, especially your economic and your social rights. Okay? So the directive principles, however, did not give rise to any legal rights for the violation of which any individual could seek a remedy, nor did these restore any power of the legislature. So also no law could be declared ultra vires on the grounds of inconsistency with these principles. That means whenever these directive principles are not implemented properly, or when you have a feeling that these directive principles are not helping an individual, so you cannot go to the courts and fight for your rights, because these are not justiciable, isn't it? But if you consider these juridical principles of state policy under your fundamental rights, okay, then you can go to the courts and fight for your rights, okay? Now, it is possible to see both fundamental rights and juridical principles as complementary to each other. That means they have to go side by side. So you cannot just think of fundamental rights becoming more powerful than the juridical principles, or juridical principles becoming more powerful than the fundamental rights. So both have to go side by side, because on one hand, your fundamental rights is going to cater to your civil and political rights, and your juridical principle for state policy is going to help your economic and social rights. Now, fundamental rights restrain the government from doing certain things. Okay, that means it prevents the government from doing different things, your fundamental rights. Okay, that means even if you have been given the right to freedom, okay, so on the right to freedom, it does not mean that you can do whatever you want. So you cannot go and start killing anyone, saying that you have the freedom, you have the freedom to do everything. But there are certain restrictions which you have to follow, isn't it? So the government is preventing you from enjoying your fundamental right to the fullest because of certain amount of restriction. Because each and everyone has to enjoy the same amount of right, or the same degree of right. So, while directive principles exhort the government to do certain things, but on the other hand, the directive principles make the government make rules and regulations in such a way that it caters to the social and economic needs of the individuals. Okay? So fundamental rights mainly protect the rights of the individuals, while directive principles ensure the well-being of the entire society. So fundamental rights got to do with an individual. It protects the rights of the individual, is it? Or it allows the individual to enjoy certain amount of rights. On the other hand, your directive principles ensure the well-being of the entire society. That means the well-being or the development of the entire society as a whole, not only the individual, but for the entire society. Okay, so many a times policies of directive principles have been taken and incorporated in the fundamental rights through amendments. So abolition of the zamindari system, midday meal system, etc. So now this has also come under your directive principles of state policy, abolition of the directive principles of state policy and the program of the midday meal. Okay, so you'll have to remember that these fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy go side by side. So one cannot do without the other, or one is not powerful than the other. Okay? Now, so it can be concluded by saying that the basic feature of the constitution is to maintain harmony between fundamental rights and the directive principles of state policy. Okay, so at the end we can say that your fundamental rights as well as the directive principles of state policy are important. So they have to go side by side, or they have to go hand in hand, because your rights will be incomplete just when you enjoy your civil and your political rights, isn't it? And maybe your rights will be incomplete if you just enjoy your civil, your social and economic rights. But you have to enjoy your economic rights, your political rights, your civil rights, as well as your social rights. So this can be possible when you have your fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy working side by side. So they are complementary and supplementary to each other. Okay? So the theme of fundamental rights must be made in light to directive principles of state policy. Okay? So this was the relationship between your fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy. So what we have discussed is, you cannot just give importance to fundamental rights only, or you cannot give importance to your directive principles of state policy only. Okay? So you have to enjoy the fundamental rights which has been given to us by the constitution, and the state government also, when they are making the rules and regulations, they have to make rules and regulations in such a way that it caters to your social and economic needs of the society. Okay, so fundamental rights is mainly concerned with the individual, and regulatory principles of state policy is concerned with the society as a whole. Okay, so this was in the relationship between the fundamental rights and regulatory principles of state policy. So with this, we come to the end of the lesson of regulatory principles of state policy. So what I would like you all to do is go through the chapter once again. Just read it through the chapter, just to have an idea, because I have already discussed the fundamental rights in detail, your directive principles of state policy in detail. So this was just a part of the lesson, that is the relationship between your fundamental rights and your directive principles of state policy. So thank you. Have a nice day. See you next time.